Hi, this video is about the big picture, why atheism is false, why only one religion can be true, and then which religion that has to be. We know atheism is false because if there was an infinite regress of cause and effects in the eternity of the past, then you would have had, by that very definition, an eternity to come into being before now. So you should have already happened, should have already existed, come and gone and died. So there cannot be an eternity of the past to cause and effects. Therefore, what you need is a cause outside of nature, which is outside of time and space being uncreated. So this uncreated creator is what we call God. Also, the universe can't come from non-existence or nothing, because that which doesn't exist can't cause anything. For example, a billion-pound gorilla can't stomp over New York because it doesn't exist. So you can't make stupid claims like that, because there's absolutely no evidence for them. We have evidence only for cause from things that do exist, not from things that don't exist. And again, therefore, nature needs a cause outside of itself. So that all the cause and effects that we observe in nature, it applies to the first cause, to the last cause, to any cause anywhere. There's always a cause. Next, an infinite regress of time and space is inherently contradictory as well, because if there was an eternity of the past to cause and effects, that indicates that there was an eternity going on before now, so that you should have never come into being. Because the eternity of the past, we continue to go on for eternity, never reaching this point. So this is how we prove, and this agrees with Romans 1:20, therefore we're all left without excuse. By just simply observing nature, we know that God exists. Now, God can't have morals below our own. Since you and I were personable and were accessible to one another, God cannot be less than that. So therefore, since God exists, he must not be, he can't be an absentee landlord, which is called deism. And he can't be a Gnostic God, in other words, a God that created, an evil God that created this universe, but he's not the ultimate creator, because a loving God would never allow that, right? So we're left with just three religions in the world that are accessible and personal. Well, let's say they're accessible. I wouldn't say they're all personal, but they're at least accessible because they comprise the majority of all faiths in the world today. And that is Christianity, Islam, and Hinduism. No, Hinduism is false because you're not going to come back as a chicken, and you can't place the burden on a chicken to become a human again. So that's just silly nonsense. And number two, Brahma is the god of Hinduism, and he's said to be amoral. But how can an amoral god, which is below a moral god, moral being, you and I, create moral beings? That wouldn't make any sense, because the lesser can't be greater than the greater. The greater can't be less than the created. So therefore, we have proven here, without a doubt, Hinduism is false. And I like to also say about Hinduism is that would be kind of unrealistic or unjust to infinitely have reincarnations occur and never effectively dealing with our sin problems, just endless sinfulness. So that's not good either. And then Islam is false because you can't come along 6 centuries later and write something down in a cave claiming that Jesus never even went to the cross or died on the cross when you have no evidence whatsoever. So just in one fell swoop, you can prove Islam false by that method. And you know Christianity has to be true because it's the only one that's left without even knowing anything else. But we do know that Christianity is true because nobody in the past 2,000 years has been able to come up with a naturalistic explanation to account for the eyewitness testimony of the apostles in various group settings. We have 12 different accounts. It's probably more, but we have at least 12 different accounts in the scriptures of the apostles testifying to having seen Jesus live from the dead in various group sizes, 5, 7, 9, 12. There's even one instance of 500. And there is no naturalistic explanation. For example, some people try to say that Jesus didn't really die on the cross, but then that wouldn't convince anybody he's the risen Messiah, would it? Because he'd be torn down to the bone. He'd have a spear in his, he'd have a hole in his heart, holes in his hands and feet. He'd be bloodied. I don't see how he could walk on the third day. So that wouldn't convince anybody. What else? Group hallucinations are impossible. We know medically speaking, in the DM4 psychology manual, for example, there's no group hallucinations. It's impossible. There's never been any group hallucinations in the history of the world. Legends theory doesn't work because there was not enough time to develop these. Like, for example, 1 Corinthians 15, Galatians 1 and 2, written by Paul. I mean, scholars all agree that this is definitely Paul's three chapters, in addition to all the other chapters and the books of the New Testament that he wrote. He said that what he received from the apostles before him is the same teaching he received from Jesus, who he saw. He said he spent 15 days with Peter, and he spent time with John and James, the brother of Jesus. So these are the original apostles that he confirmed the same eyewitness testimony with, and he was converted just a couple of years after the cross. Jesus died on the cross in 33 AD. He wrote Galatians 1 and 2 and 1 Corinthians 15. He wrote that around 40 AD, so it's very near to the events that took place. You can quote all the church fathers, you can quote the entire New Testament from the church fathers in the late 1st and 2nd century, except for 11 verses. And we have about 15 still surviving papyri from the late 1st century and the 2nd century from the New Testament. And there is no document in all of antiquity that has still surviving papyri that are so close to the events that occurred. So that's pretty powerful. And of course, Jesus is the most documented person in antiquity. There's more sources written about him within 150 years of his death than any 10 figures combined. So if Jesus didn't exist and do what he did, then nobody did anything, because you can't have a double standard and apply one standard to others with less material as evidence than what Jesus has. And we have 45 sources for Jesus within 150 years of his death. And 17 of those sources are non-Christian sources. And of those 17 non-Christian sources, 12 speak of his death, and 12 speak of his resurrection, and 7 of them speak of his deity. So even though they don't believe that Jesus is God, they still speak of the claim of his deity. 7 of them that are non-Christian that do that. Anyway, so you can see how simple it is. So that if you don't get it, Jesus spoke about hell more than anybody, that if you don't come to the cross and receive what he did for you as Lord and Savior, that you will then go to hell. So just realize, whatever hell is, it is a place that you freely choose to go to because you don't accept the forgiveness that he provides for you on the cross. For whatever reason you do that, you don't want, maybe you prefer to be independent, self-sustaining, self-righteous, independent, disobedient. It's the same sort of thing with Adam and Eve in the garden. They disobeyed. You disobey. May even know God exists, but it's one thing to, even the angels know God exists. So if you don't accept what he did for you, you have to not only know that he exists, but you have to accept what he did for you. You know, there was Cain and Abel. Abel gave a proper offering of a sheep, not of his own labor. Whereas Cain pridefully gave of his own works, which could never satisfy God, and therefore he was not saved. And so it's very simple. God is looking for a particular kind of person who accepts his authority, and not to go independently in your own path, in your own way. And this is why Christianity is true, and it's the only way. Praise the Lord. Okay, bye.